it sort of grew and grew until it became its own thing. It became, as I refer to it, as a monster. Somehow, I mean, the original idea was to get practice in what is a vaulting like, what is certain types of architecture, whether it's Renaissance or Baroque or whatever, to have a feeling of togetherness with it, you know, and the only way you could do that was to build it in the form of a model and then to understand it. I started building it in segments, always make room for room or parts of it, which I would then take down to Munich and build them into the general plan of it. Like the vases in that room, those are things that I collect, and if I find them, I buy them. But they have to be small, very small. I have to see the complete dimensions of everything in order to understand it. I had to see it, I had to feel the depth of it.
But Herbert Cherix has done much more than his castle. He has worked as a stage designer for over 50 years and has been involved in more than 200 plays.
One of the reasons why I would make such involved models of them was the fact that that was the only way that I could show them what I wanted, to have it look when it was finished. How you get there, I don't care, but that's the way it has to look.
Never mind his accent, Herbert Cherix is a true New Yorker. Raised in the Big Apple in the 1930s, he was born to be in the arts.
I was never held down in any way by my parents. It was very liberal and I was allowed to do whatever I pleased. It's a sort of a life that we lead where we are very serious in the arts. My father did all sorts of odd jobs, everything from dishwashing to whatever he would find. And he ended up not as a dishwasher because his hands were considered to be not the hands for a dishwasher. And he ended up in a French hand laundry, Madame Soucas. French hand laundry. A customer came in and he said, "Who ironed my shirts?" It turned out that that man was none other than composer Cole Porter. And Madame Soucas said, "Well, that must have been Frank." And he says, "I want him to do them like this all the time. It's the first time that I've worn shirts that didn't cut me in the throat, because in those days they would starch them to a great extreme." And then when my father opened his own hand laundry in the Bronx, the chauffeur would always bring his shirts to be ironed. And so my father had a very illustrious customer from the very beginning.
But as a young man, he had to leave his home. It was during the Korean War that his country called for duty.
I was drafted into the army in Germany, which was actually, I couldn't have expected it any better. I was sort of hoping that would happen, because it was during the Korean War. I could have ended up in a hot spot in Korea also, which I didn't want to have to take any part in. I don't know if I was a good soldier at all. So I couldn't shoot straight. I was more afraid of the weapon that I had in my hand than the weapon had of me. One of the first things they ask you, what do? Do you cook? Well, of course, then you ended up as a cook in the army, which wasn't such a very hot job. And then I waited until the end. And then, could you drive? No, I never had a driver's license in my life. And then they asked, who can work with a press camera? And then I raised my hand because I thought, I'll get away with it. I ended up the photographer. And I was there for everybody who needed me. And that was perfect. And They decided, well, actually what I like is set designing. I'm always making models of things, but I have no schools. I don't know of any schools in America where I could study. And then I went to the university in Munich, and then I met up with the teacher there, that was Emil Pretorius, and then I was taken up in the academy. But that wasn't so easy. I had to get out of the army first. But in those days, they didn't discharge you in Europe. You had to go back to the United States. And that was something I wanted to avoid doing, because I had this funny feeling if I went back, I would never return again. I wouldn't find the power to do that. My parents, they found support in a senator. He says, of course, that he's going to write them a letter. And then he said, this man, young man is to be discharged in Munich honorably. And then that's exactly the way it happened.
1965, am 1. August, am Stadttheater in Bern. Da lernte ich Herbert Scherreis kennen, einen Bühnenbildner, der schon viel erwachsener war als ich, 13 Jahre älter. Ich fand es ganz toll, einen solchen Freund zu haben, weil er ein ausgezeichneter Mitvollzieher war. Im Theater ist ja so, Meisterregisseur entwickelt eine Idee, eine Konzeption, und jetzt kommt der Bühnenbildner dazu und die beiden reiben sich. Man sucht natürlich so einen Kosmos von Einheit, Einheit von Raum und Zeit.
Frank Helmond und Herbert Scherreis worked together on Shakespeare's King Lear.
Im Lear, da haben wir gesagt, da war die auch wieder die Einheit von Zeit und Raum, und da haben wir den Kosmos uns so gedacht, dass zunächst mal die ganze riesige Bühne, Münster ist eine riesige Bühne, mit einem feudalroten Tuch bedeckt war und der ganze königliche Zauber dort noch spielte, und ab dem Moment, wenn es in die Wüste ging, wurde das ganze Tuch weggezogen, hinten mechanisch weggezogen, und drunter war eine riesige Sanddüne.
With a simple set design, the costumes were the centerpiece of the play.
Like Lear, who is at the beginning of the production, a very sure of himself king, sovereign, stands there with all his orders and things, and his cape of state, and being a king.
Kostüme haben da reingepasst. Das ist eben das Inspirierende von Herbert, dass man ihm Vorgaben gibt, inhaltlich und formaler Art, und er das umsetzt, dass es eine eigene Welt wird.
Now that Herbert Scherreis has stopped working for theaters, his newest creations are what he calls boxes.
What is the magic behind
no,
the box?
The boxes have their own dimensions. It might be just a simple little thing like when it rains, it's wet. You know, I mean, I haven't done anything like that, but it's just come to mind. I go off into mythical things, like Mercurius, or like a Hercules, a series of Hercules sets. And then I did a series of boxes where I did them in red chalk, taking off on red chalk drawings of the 19th century. There's a certain romantic to ruins.
Then after building your own castle here, you actually moved into one.
I stayed there up until last year, when I decided it is not going to work out anymore for me. I mean, I retreated, you could say, to the studio here. This was always my workshop anyway, even in all the years that I was out in Kalling.
Er ist ein kunsthistorisches, wandelndes Lexikon. Wir waren zusammen in Rom. Er konnte mir bei jeder Villa genau erklären, warum nun in diesem Wappen genau diese Fahne fehlt. Da drüben aber, und daraus ergeben sich Geschichten, Geschichten, Geschichten.
50 years in the making, Herbert Scherreis has just warmed up.
Well, I don't know. I don't know. There's nothing that releases you in the arts. I think you become part of it. I think if I would have become a monk, I would still be a monk. Even with my attacks of Parkinson, I just don't feel like giving up. It's a therapy for me also. You know, so I'll be doing it a long time. As long as somebody still wants to work with me, I will do it. And besides, I mean, I have good ideas. I think I'm still around. I'm not going that fast.